the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, and afterward more heavily oppressed her by the way of the sea beyond the Jordan, in Galilee of the Gentiles, the people who have walked in darkness have seen a great light, and those who dwell in the land of the shadow of death, upon them a light has shone. You have multiplied the nation and increased its joy. They rejoice before you according to the joy of the harvest, as men rejoice when they divide the spoil. For you have broken the yoke of his burden and the staff off of his shoulder, and you have destroyed the rod of his oppressor. For unto us, verse 9, a child is born. Unto us a son is given, and the government of God shall be upon his shoulder, and he shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Now I'm going to go to John chapter 1, verses 1 to about 18. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him, nothing is made that was made. In him is life, and this life is the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. This man came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all through him might believe. He was not that light, but he was sent to bear witness of that light, that true light, which gives light to every man coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him. He came unto his own, and his own did not receive him. But as many as received him, to them he gave the power, or the right, to become the children of God, to those who believe in his name, who are born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. John bore witness of him and cried out, saying, This is he of whom I said, He who comes after me is preferred before me, for he was before me, and of his fullness we have all received grace for grace. For the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has seen God at any time, but the only begotten Son, who is in the bosom of the Father, he has declared him. Finally, Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 to 11. Let this mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who though he was God, did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges, and he took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. And when he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on the cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. And everyone said, Amen. Amen. And before I get into the message, just one final announcement. After this service, Mrs. Lapos has a special Christmas dinner with activities and some gifts we want to give out. So please, after the service, make your way downstairs right away so we can get into the food and just bless you before we get into the Christmas holiday. Now, you know something that you say or write down has been given to you by the Holy Spirit, because as you speak it or as you read it, it profoundly affects your heart and it shapes you to the very foundation. And the truth that is revealed to you stays with you for many days afterward. Well, that happened to me this last couple of weeks. I was deeply moved by one section of last week's message, Jesus and You. And it was about how Jesus came into the world and what it means for you and me personally. So I'm going to repeat some of the things I said with a couple of additions, and I hope it blesses you as it blessed me. Jesus was born like all of us, but he was born in the middle of the night, when it was dark and cold, just like some of the nights that you spent that are dark and cold. The conditions were far from perfect. We all know about conditions that are far from perfect because we've all gone through those types of conditions. So did Jesus. It was a challenge, to say the least, He was born in a remote stable, away from everybody. Only a handful of people knew about it. But that's not the most significant thing. The most significant thing is that he came into a family. He was born to a married man and a married woman who were married to each other. Not to two women, not to two men, but two people married to each other. And by that, he confirmed the family. He lived in a home in a small town. For 30 years of his human life, he was part of a community. He had brothers. He was part of the synagogue. And everything was very, very personal. And Jesus subjected himself willingly to the human condition. For the first 30 years of his life, he lived a mundane, routine, obscure life, and no one, absolutely no one, knew who he was. And so he knows about perhaps your mundane, routine life. He knows that maybe you don't have a lot of people in your life supporting you. He knows that if you had one or two really close friends, you're a rich, rich individual. He knows all about what you're going through. He knows exactly what you and I go through from day to day in this unloving, unfeeling, ruthless, unforgiving world. He's experienced everything you have experienced or will experience. You can never excuse Jesus. You can never accuse Jesus of not understanding what you're going through. You can never accuse him of that because he's been through it all. Now it's true, he doesn't fix everything. Please understand that. Accept it. Stop fighting. He doesn't fix everything. He doesn't always change everything or turn it around. He didn't even do that for himself. When he was hungry, he didn't create food out of nowhere to eat. He remained hungry and looked to the same means that we looked to be fed. When he was cold, he shivered, even though he easily could have snapped his fingers and created heat. When he was rejected, slandered, and mocked, he didn't unleash his glory and mow down his enemies with power and light. When he was betrayed and forsaken, he didn't take revenge. He wept. He was hurt. He agonized like you and me. And when he was beaten and pierced, he cried out, just like you cry out when you're beaten and pierced. The hymn says he could have called 10,000 angels. But he didn't. He chose to suffer instead. And when he struggled with laying down his life for all of us, he released all resistance and fully yielded to the Father's will, even though he could have walked away from it. Why did he do it that way? He did it that way to teach us to cope with our condition the same way he did. How did he cope? Not by exhibiting his power as God the Son, no. He coped by trusting God and throwing himself on the mercy of God and his throne. And that's what he expects every one of us to do. Trust in God and throw ourselves on his mercy and his throne. And so Jesus understands. He understands fully. And it all began on the very first Christmas, the night that he was born. Hebrews 3:14 to 16 says, seeing that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who can't sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in a time of need. Hebrews 2:14 to 18 says, because God's children are human beings, made of flesh and blood, the Son also became flesh and blood, for only as a human being could he die, and only by dying could he break the power of the devil who had the power of death. Only in this way could he set free all who had lived their lives as slaves to the fear of dying. We also know that the Son did not come to help angels, but he came to help the descendants of Abraham, that's you and me. Therefore, it was necessary for him to be made in every respect like us, his brothers and sisters, so he could be our powerful, merciful, and faithful high priest before God. Then he could offer a sacrifice that would take away the sins of the people. And since he himself has gone through suffering and testing, he is able to help us when we are being tested. Now, all of that displays the heart of Jesus Christ. To this day, he wishes to be born, not in Bethlehem, but born again in your heart and in your life by the Spirit of God. He wants to be born in your life privately and personally bring you alive to the things of God. He wants to make your home his home. He wants to make your life his life. He wants to make your family his family. Think of what happens when you open your life to Jesus Christ. If you don't know, I'm here to tell you. Jesus begins to perfect you from within. You become a better man. You become a better woman. A better husband and wife. A better mother and father. You become a better partner, friend, and companion. The dark portions of your soul are filled with his light. Fear becomes faith and trust. Resentment becomes love, mercy, and grace. Dishonesty becomes integrity. Confusion becomes certainty. Cowardice becomes courage. Anxiety becomes peace. Discouragement becomes hope. Addiction becomes freedom. And the list goes on and on. You discover that Jesus himself is the ultimate Christian gift, a Christmas gift. He gladly gives himself to you. He will gladly come to you. He loves you. He empowers you. He decorates you with his holiness. He elevates you. He enlightens you. He teaches you. He guides you. And all the things that he does for you are as endless as he is eternal. In Jesus, you receive everything that is good. Everything. In Jesus, you receive everything that you need. And this is underscored in Romans 8. Romans 8, verses 31 to 37. What shall we say about these wonderful things? If God is for us, who can be against us? Since he did not spare even his own son, but gave him up for us all, won't he also give us everything else? Who dares to accuse us whom God has chosen for his own? No, for God himself has given us right standing with himself. Who then will condemn us? No one. For Jesus Christ died for us and was raised to life, and he is seated in the place of honor at God's right hand, pleading for us. Can anything ever separate us from the love of Christ? Does it mean he no longer loves us if we have trouble or calamity or we're persecuted or hungry or destitute or in danger or threatened with death? As the scripture says, for your sake, all day long we are killed like sheep going to the slaughter. But despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours in Jesus Christ who loved us. Verse 38 to 39. I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love, neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today or our worries about tomorrow, not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. No power in the sky above or in the earth below, indeed nothing in all creation, will be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Jesus Christ our Lord. And on a personal level, that's what Christmas is all about. And that's what I call the little picture of Christmas, a little picture of Christmas. But there's a big picture as well, and I wanted to discuss that with you today, the big picture of Christmas. Isaiah declared, unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government of God shall be upon his shoulder, and he shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. A child unto us is born. That means the child had a beginning. The child had an entry point. The child was not always in existence, but he began to exist when he was conceived in Mary's womb by the power of the Holy Spirit. So we know that Jesus Christ is fully human. And that's vital, because if he's fully human, that he was able to represent us on the cross as a substitute to die in our place for our sins. If he was anything less than a real man, he could not represent us before God at all. Furthermore, we know that Jesus was without sin. The egg And the seed that fertilized the egg was supplied by God. It didn't come from Mary. It was not Mary's egg. If it hadn't been Mary's egg, sin would have passed on to the body of Jesus genetically. So both the egg and the sperm were provided by God miraculously in the womb of Mary, and she was just a carrier of the Son of God, God in the flesh. We know he was sinless and therefore innocent. So the sin he paid for on the cross couldn't possibly be his own. It was our sin. Unto us, a child is born. Unto us, a son is given. That speaks of Jesus' divinity. He was fully God. God the Son. As God, he can't be born. As God, he's always existed. He and the Father are one. So he is eternal. And since he has always been there, he can only be given. He cannot be born. He can't be spoken into existence. He's always existence, and existed, and today he's given to you. Unto us, a son is given. Because he's fully God, he can represent God and man on the cross and join us together forever. And in doing that, he brings God to the nations. He lifts the burdens and the sufferings that come from greed and pride and sin. It says in Isaiah chapter 9, he breaks the yoke of the old nature that is set upon us. He destroys the oppressor, the devil. He establishes a new order that is set upon us, the first righteous nation to ever exist, the kingdom of God. A kingdom ruled by God, of which we can all be a part of now. And in that way, he changes the world. He changes the world, and soon he will finish changing the world. Jesus is coming back again. And the kingdoms of this world shall become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ. The birth of Jesus answers every philosophical question ever asked. Who is God? What is man? And how can he be improved? Jesus was glad to become a man to show us. He didn't lose anything or diminish himself by becoming a man, because man is created in the image of God, and all he did was add flesh to his own image. That's deep theology.
He put flesh on his own image.
He put a body to his glory. He gave himself real eyes and real ears, physical hands and feet, a face and a voice that could be seen and heard and touched. And even though he was God, and he could have displayed immense power and glory and unmistakable revelation by using his full power on earth, he didn't do that. Because Jesus, God in the flesh, did not come to earth to show off. He came to perfect us and to free us from the darkness of our sin. He came to demonstrate the path necessary for all of us to be lifted up into what we were meant to be. And so he emptied himself, Philippians chapter 2 says. He put aside all of his divine glory. He set aside his indescribable power. He hid his glory and his power in the greatest act of humility the world has ever seen. You could never know just by looking at him that he was God. I'll say it again, you'd never know just by looking at him that he was God. Because he came as a simple craftsman, a working class man, a carpenter, with a modest income. He surrendered himself to the authorities to be butchered and crucified. He obeyed the Father's will, even unto death, the death of the cross. And for that, Philippians chapter 2, 11 says, God has highly exalted him. So what's the message in this? What was Jesus trying to say that for years philosophers have been trying to answer? How is man perfected? Philosophers will tell you that man is perfected. Man reaches his full potential. Man elevates himself to what God created him to be by promoting himself and sticking out his chest and glorifying himself. But the message that Jesus shared with us is that man is perfected, reaches his full potential, elevates himself to what God created him to be by laying down his life, by bowing down, by yielding, by surrendering, by trusting, and by resting on the living God who created him. Not pushing, not striving, not bullying, not straining, not working himself to death to make it to the top. Because promotion can only come from God. It was God who highly exalted Jesus because Jesus submitted himself to the will of the Father. And in doing that, he established a principle that runs contrary, completely contrary to everything that the world teaches. And that principle is this: the way up is not up. The way up is not up. Forcing yourself, asserting yourself to get ahead, stepping on people on the way up the ladder of success, that's not the way up. Jesus established once and for all that the way down is up. The way down is up. Denying yourself, dying to yourself, living for God, and trusting him to take care of the rest. That's how man is perfected. And this is a vital message for all of human history. Because by the time Jesus came on the scene, four major empires had come and gone, and they all had their own ideas of how to perfect man. Now, I don't have time to elaborate on the details of each, but I can give you the basics. Babylon said man is glorified by his wealth and splendor. The Medes and Persians said man is glorified by writing and enforcing laws. The Greeks said no, man is glorified by educating him and building up his body. Only in this way can he be perfected. And Rome said man is glorified through power and might and force combined with the education and physical emphasis of the Greeks. And to this world, to this day, the world still believes all of that. To this day, the Western secular world still believes all of that. But Jesus came and shot all of that to pieces when he taught us beyond any shadow of a doubt that man is glorified when he's joined together and separately with God. And only then is he elevated and perfected. Because it's God who creates the wealth that Babylon said elevates a man. It's only God who can write his laws on the heart of men and make them holy and righteous. No one else can. It's only God who educates us and builds us up, not just with knowledge, not just with academic knowledge, but with wisdom that comes from his heart. And the only power and might man can possess without destroying himself, the only might and power that man can possess without destroying himself is the power of God. Any other power will compel a man to abuse and oppress the people around him because he's got to hang on to that power, and there's always somebody who wants to usurp him and take his place. That's why you have gangs shooting each other. That's why you have criminals wiping each other out. That's why you have dictators declaring war. That's why you have somebody in North Korea, a madman, who's ready to blow up the world to demonstrate how strong he is. Power, the power of man leads to destruction. The power of God perfects and elevates man. And the power of God flows out of his presence and nowhere else. Any other power other than the power of God is poison. It's death. Stalin is dead. Mao Zedong is dead. Idi Amin is dead. Name me any one of the dictators of our time. Adolf Hitler is dead. Bismarck is dead. Julius Caesar has long been dead. Even Muhammad is dead. But Jesus Christ lives. All of that was established by the life of Jesus, which began on the first Christmas. And then finally, Jesus answers all the religious and spiritual questions as well. What are those questions? What is the truth about God? Who is he? How can we know him? And for that matter, who in the world was Jesus Christ? What's he all about? And that was answered in John chapter 1, which we read at the beginning of the message. Jesus is the Word of God. He is co-equal, co-substantial with God. He is God. That's why the Bible says in the beginning the Word was with God and the Word was God. Jesus created all things, and nothing exists or can exist apart from him. All of everything that you see was created and spoken into existence by Jesus Christ. John tells us that Jesus is the light of the world. His ways, his truth, his principles are perfect and superior to any man or any collection of men. He and he alone has revealed who God is, whom the Father is. Apart from Jesus, no one has ever understood who God is. No one has ever reached God. But God has come to us face to face in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we can know God and be close to God and be joined to God through Jesus Christ forever and only through Christ. So can I repeat the verses from John chapter 1, 14 to 18? The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. John bore witness of him and cried out, saying, This is he of whom I said, He who comes after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. And verse 16 says, Of his fullness we have all received grace for grace. For the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth come through Jesus Christ. And here's the important verse. No one has seen God at any time, but the only begotten Son, that's Jesus, who's in the bosom of the Father, he has revealed him. And all of that is the big picture of what Christmas is all about. So I hope this has brought deeper meaning to you, a deeper understanding, so that you can more effectively and more meaningfully celebrate this season. More than that, I hope it will motivate you to change your life and to get closer to the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to close this message with the words of my favorite Christmas carol. It's my favorite because it says it all. We already sang it. But it impacts a very special power when you read it. Hark, the herald angels sing. Glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild. God and sinners reconciled. Joyful, all ye nations rise. Join the triumph of the skies. With the angelic host proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark, the herald angels sing, Glory to the newborn King. Here's where it really gets powerful. Christ, by highest heaven adored. Christ, the everlasting Lord. Late in time, behold, he comes, offspring of the Virgin's womb. Veiled in flesh, the Godhead see. Hail the incarnate deity, pleased as man with men to dwell. Jesus, our Emmanuel, hark, the herald angels sing. Glory to the newborn King. Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace. Hail the Son of Righteousness, light and life to all he brings, risen with healing in his wings. Mild he lays his glory by, born that man no more may die, born to raise the sons of earth, born to give them second birth. Hark, the herald angels sing. Glory to the newborn King. Would you bow your heads, please? Joseph. And that's what Christmas is all about. I'm wondering if there's anyone today who has never asked Jesus into their heart. You don't know him. You're separated from him. You don't know much about him. You've learned everything you need to know today. And the truth that I've shared with you today is an everlasting truth. You may walk out of this place and forget all about it, but sooner or later, this truth is going to come back into your life. Because in the end, Jesus Christ will reign. He will return. He will set up his kingdom. But before then, he wants an opportunity to come into your life unwitnessed of what Jesus can do. I don't want to go into all the details of my testimony, but I can tell you this, that without him, I wouldn't be alive today. I'd have been dead. But I'm still here at the age of 64. And I've lived a wonderful, beautiful life, and I only expected to get better. But that's not the reason Jesus came. That's a side benefit. The reason Jesus came was to bring you back to himself. We are born separated from God. God is not in our lives. We have to invite him in. We have to commit ourselves to him by an act of our will. Yes, Jesus, I want you in my life. And that's the only way he will come in. He will not force himself. He will not break down the door of your heart. But he's here and he's knocking. And if you will let him in, he will come in today. Your sins will be forgiven. Your slate will be wiped clean. You'll have a brand new start in life. And this time you'll have God in your life, the creator of the universe and the sky's the limit. So while your heads are bowed and your eyes are closed, I'd like to ask if there's anyone here who would raise their hands and say, yeah, I want to ask Jesus into my life. It's time. Is there anyone? Oh, come.